What I'm going to discuss briefly here with you is how can really a physicist to contribute any useful way to contain the spread of the COVID-19 pandemic. And I'm Zhifeng Ren, currently I'm at the physics department and also Texas Center for Superconductivity and at the University of Houston. And this work was mainly carried out by my postdoc, Dr. Lo Yu, and he's here with me. And also I would like to declare there is no financial conflict of interest, okay? And let me see, what's the problem? Somehow the moving forward, the slide, yeah, okay, now it goes. Before I start the real content, I would like to introduce, especially to some young people, especially students. As we know, the major physics subfield, you know, physics is pretty, pretty broad. And there are many subfields. For example, some of you, if you have been studying physics, you know nuclear and particle physics, atomic, molecular, optical physics, condensed matter physics. And inside condensed matter physics, there are many other subdivisions. I'm not going to read every one of them. Very important branch is the solid state physics. Of course, nowadays, the nano scale physics and many other subdivisions. And then also there are astrophysics, another huge sub-branch. And of course, applied physics, which is really touches basically almost every aspect of our daily life, okay? And inside applied physics, and then you can see there are many, many other subdivisions. And my talk today will touch the engineering physics, material physics, and solid state devices, basically. And what speak of physics or physicists, the contribution by physicists, I just want to briefly bring this to your attention, some historical contributions by physicists to the society. As we know, in 1800s, Newton found the universal gravitation. That's pretty fundamental law of the universe and or for any objects. In the 1800s, Maxwell found the relationship between electricity and magnetism. You know, when you have a changing electrical current, you produce a magnetic field, and vice versa, you have a magnetic field moving object in magnetic field, you produce electricity. All sorts of those things, the very fundamental, very important, and our current society is completely built on all those principles. And then obviously in 1900, Einstein's relativity, special and general theory on relativity and defines the basics of physics. And obviously in the 1940s, nuclear bomb was made successfully, and that ends the Second World War. That's important. And in 1960s, man landed on moon. That's a milestone for human being exploration of outer space. And in 1980s, cell phones were started, and nowadays in the whole world, I don't believe there are too many people without cell phones, which basically has been affecting our life, daily life so significantly. So all those contributions are by physicists. And now, and also for the future driverless vehicles is going to be dominating our life. And as you know, that Tesla has these driverless cars going on the road. And as I can tell you, probably a lot of you have never tested Tesla, driving Tesla yet. I had a very, very brief ride and driving of the driverless Tesla because my older son came back from California, drove a Tesla. And basically you don't have to do anything. You just sit there, the car goes where you want. When the car sees the traffic light and also when the cars in front of you slow down and the car automatically slows down and stops if needed. And this kind of thing in the future will drastically reduce the car accident because the machines, the computers can react much faster than our brains can do. So that's a very, very brief historical contributions by physicists. And the reason I'm talking about this is just want to tell you that a physicist can basically contribute to every aspect of the society. And of course, not saying physics, the whole world just need a physicist. That's absolutely not true. We need physicists, we need chemists, we need mathematicians, we need engineers, we need all kinds of people to make the society work. And come to the COVID-19 pandemic, since we are talking about a pandemic, and then I would like to go over with you a few common facts that's very important. Well, fact number one is the worldwide infected now, it's more than 100 million, and deaths already more than 2 million people. And very unfortunately, in the United States, we have quarter of whole world infected deaths, and also 20% of the deaths of the whole world, which is very shocking, very, very surprising. And especially consider United States population is only 5% of the world. And why we have this many, much higher percentage of the infected cases and also deaths. This must be something related to the way we have been handling this pandemic. So the reason for this high out proportion of our population is because the virus, SARS-CoV-2 virus, is airborne. And the government, United States government, and also the CDC did not formally, officially recognize airborne virus was the major transmission until sometime August, which is why caused this huge problem, this mess in United States. And clearly, since a person, if you carry the virus, and then you can see they breathe out, and the other person breathes in, and then you get into trouble. And how to prevent this? Clearly, it's very simple and also effective way, but not necessarily convenient way, is a mask. You know, mask is really, really important. So there was some statistics saying that if the person who has the virus wear the mask, for anybody, if keep a social distance and the chance to get the transmitted, contracted virus reduced to only 15%. And if the person who is in close proximity with the person who has the virus also wear the mask, and then the possibility reduced to less than 5% or even 2%. So that shows mask is very useful. However, mask is very, very inconvenient. As you, some of you probably already experienced all those things. There are a few things with the mask, okay? For the people wear glasses, and as you can see, when you breathe out, very often the fog, your eyeglasses, your glasses get very foggy, and that's very inconvenient. And secondly, there is also a health issue. When you breathe out the carbon dioxide, and you really would like to breathe in fresh air, but inside the mask, you are going to breathe in some of the carbon dioxide you just breathed out. If a sick person carries virus, you are going to breathe a lot of virus back into you. That's not good. Also, the third issue, major issue, is when you wear a mask, you cannot eat nor drink. If you take off the mask, that's where the risk is in order to eat or drink. So is it possible there are other ways we can really take out the virus without too much risk? So one effective way to contain the spread of COVID-19 virus is really by designing and testing a filter to catch and kill COVID-2 virus. And this filter, normal filter, next slide I'm going to talk about, we have different kind of filters. They can do filtering, but they cannot kill the virus. So what we decided to do is we want to have a heated filter. So that means that that filter can be heated up to above 100 degrees C. And when virus goes to the filter, and it will be instantaneously killed instead of just stay on the filter and also continue at a later stage going through the filter back to the air circulation system. And let me just briefly tell you the filters we are using. You probably, everybody knows this, in any closed space, we always have filters. Whenever you, if you have air circulation, you always have filters. And normally filters have different kind of levels. They use a system, so-called minimum efficiency reporting value, MERV, and then to indicate what kind of efficiency it is. So give you example, MERV 16, it says that up to 75% for particles between 0.3 to 1 microns. That means anything above that particle size will be 75% filtered. So that's only 75%, I have to remember that. And then the filter here, MERV has many kind of levels, and MERV 16 is pretty high already. And then the filter looks like this. And you probably, if you have replaced a few times of the filter in your home, you have noticed that this is kind of pleated kind of filter paper with the paper outside and also with some metal mesh to hold the pleating in place. And that's the normal filters you use in your home. But that's not going to be effective or useful at all for COVID-19 virus. And then on the market, in some special, very clean environment, we are indeed using very much higher efficiency filters. And this is so-called high efficiency particulate air filtering, which is called HEPA. And then in comparison with MERV, you can see HEPA can filter any particles above 0.3 microns with the efficiency 99.97%. That's much, much higher than the MERV filters. Those kind of HEPA filters have been used in clean rooms, hospital, surgical rooms, and has not been widely used to all places. Normally, I don't think any home is using the HEPA filter at all. And the reason for that is because HEPA filter is pretty bulky. Instead of just like a MERV filter, 1 or 2 or 3, 4 inches thick, and this HEPA filter from the front to the back has to be, you know, like a foot thick. The reason for that is because the filtering paper has this high efficiency for this small, such a small particles. And then the porosity and to let it air through, it's very small. And so in order to let enough air through, so that's why you have to pleat this steps, 12 inches steps. So, and then also this kind of filters in bulk macro scale, you look like this. And then in micro scale, what are the filters, you know, exactly HEPA filters are? So basically if you blow into many magnifications many times, and you can see inside it's the fibers, it's the micron size fibers, and then they randomly laid in such a way so that the pore size is much smaller than a micron. That's why you can filter in 0.3 micron filters at 99.97%, okay? And obviously the traditional HEPA filter cannot be used for the COVID-19 purpose if you do want to kill the virus on the filter, because traditional filter, HEPA filter, the filter paper, and also a lot of materials they use, they cannot take temperature above 100 degrees C. So we designed a new so-called heated HEPA filter and to take care of the virus, catch and kill the virus. So let me give you a brief outline first, and then I will go into more designing and science of this filter. So on March 31st, last year, 2020, I got a call from, got an email from Dr. Pell here in Houston, basically asking for assistance on making filters using metal, so that it can have a heat conduction to kill COVID-19 virus. And right the next day, April 1st, we started to do the filter designing and the testing. And the whole design and testing was done in April, basically. So in May, we took the filter we designed. Of course, we designed the filter, and then we have to use a design also making a housing to put the filter in. So that we can test use the real virus. This virus we used is from the first patient of the United States, COVID patient in the United States in Seattle. And the virus from that patient was cultured and sent it to Galveston National Biodefense Laboratory. So we took our device there and used their virus and then did the testing. And there was found in April, in May, was very successful. The efficiency for catching and killing the virus, so basically, is above 99.9%. That's fairly efficient. So as soon as we demonstrated that, and in June, we wrote the paper and submitted the paper, and in July, the paper was published. And of course, when the paper was published, we did a news release. And within 1 week, that news was viewed by more than, more than 2 billion people worldwide. So that's very, so obviously people are very interested in new ways to catching and killing the virus. And so back approaching to the end of July and after the paper is published, so much the media and society attention and we were trying to start to make the units, the moving units. And within very short time, from July to mid of August, and then the first unit, mobile units, 10 units were deployed to multiple schools in Texas, in Florida. And by now, only a few months later, the company has delivered more than 1,000 units to all kinds of places, which I'm going to tell you later. So here, let me go back to the basic requirement of a filter, okay, for cleaning the air. And so for filter, it has to be very highly porous so that air can flow through without too much resistance. Because any filter, you want to provide as much clean air as possible, especially for large space like the convention centers, where lots of people traffic, right? But on the other hand, it is also a dilemma. And in order to have, you know, if it's too porous, you cannot catch the particles, like a COVID-19 particle, less than 0.3 microns. So you have to make the hole smaller. And when the small is too hole, when the hole is too small, and then the airflow volume reduces, which is why we had to use this kind of pleating. And also another very additional important, also very challenging task is, has to be able to be heated up at least 100 degrees, preferably to 200 degrees C, so that we can kill the virus instantaneously. Okay, and this is the challenge we were facing. Now, if we want to heat the filter up to, you know, above 100 degrees C, and then there's another challenge comes. So all the filters, especially during the summertime, if you install it in your room or into any HVAC system, you cannot heat the air to that temperature. Otherwise, your air conditioning system cannot handle, you know, 100 degrees C. You want to reduce it to back to 20, some room temperature. That's very challenging. And so that's how we came up with a idea. We, instead of use the traditional heater, we use a metal foam, especially like we started with nickel foam, and which is highly porous. And also electrically conducting, and we can use the electrical power to heat it up. But the other challenge for nickel foam was nickel foam is a metal. The electrical resistance was too small. And as we know, like nickel, you know, copper, aluminum, or gold, when the resistance is too small, it basically is a conductor. It doesn't generate any heat, just let the electrical power pass through. So, and we had to face the challenge how to make the resistance of the nickel foam high enough so that we can really generate heat on the nickel foam. And then here, I'm showing you the commercial nickel foam. This is the commercial nickel foam, can be as a rolls. And obviously you can cut a piece and then measure the resistivity was very low. And that's why we had to pleat. And the good thing, when you pleat it, you increase the length and the resistance increases. So in this way, we can really measure it. So here I'm showing you, this is a 10 millimeter wide, 250 millimeter long, and the nickel foam normally is 1.6 millimeter thick. And we did the measurement, apply current measure resistance, and we know the resistivity. Look at here, the resistivity is only 1.4 times 10 to minus 5 ohm meter. That's very low. So which is why it's very difficult to raise the temperature up. And but, you know, nevertheless, if you use the pretty for this small one, you can apply like 6.5 watts, you can get 210 degrees C, okay? So that's good. and at least we have the temporary drop. And then if you have a flat nickel foam, you just heat it up. And then both sides, you lose all the heat by radiation, by conduction, by convection. And then you really use a lot of electrical power to get the temperature up. At the same time, that heat, as I pointed out before, is going to transfer to the air, which is going to go down to the air handling system. And then it's not really preferable. Okay, so we have to pleat it, just like fold this up. And then after you fold up and you increase the resistance, you reduce the power consumption. At the same time, the areas which lose the heat, it's much smaller than the flat. And then only the edges, the bending parts are losing heat. So this is why for the folded one, you can at the same current voltage, and you can get to 100, above 100 degrees C, but for the flat, you cannot get that high temperature, okay? And so here is the testing device. This is the middle where the filter is, it looks like this. And in order to increase the resistance, we had to make into 6 compartments, and between each one, two of them, like here, it's connected here and connected here, it put all of them in series so that the total length is 6 times, and then this cross section become only 1/6 of the cross section. So this way, your resistance increased by 36 times. So that's why we can heat it up. And here is the filter, that's the gas in, that's the upper stream. Oh, here, the gas in carry the virus and through the filter and then coming out. And then we know how many virus we put it in, and then we have to take sample gas from this exit and test how many virus still live there. And but first we tested the temperature, there's no problem. We can reach 200 degrees C with or without airflow. That's really good. And after that, let me see what's my time. I think I still have some time. So with that, and then we took to the Galveston National Lab, and then we did the testing. Before filter, of course, we noted the virus. You have the 100% virus there. After the filter, and then we took the air, we did a cultural meeting, and we found it. Very small percentage. First testing, the virus arrived. And then, when we were in Galveston National Lab testing the virus, and then those bio defense people were telling us, COVID-19 virus nowadays is it's a hot topic, it's a big threat to the society. But COVID-19 virus, in comparison with many other bio virus or bio species, it's nothing. Especially like the anthrax, SARS-CoV-2 is basically very benign in comparison with anthrax. And in the world right now, there's no good way you can catch and kill anthrax. If your filter can catch and kill anthrax virus, that would be even more useful. So they did the experiment, and the very first experiment they found it's very effective, even more effective than the SARS-CoV-2. So we got so excited, that's why this paper was quickly reviewed and published. And so here I'm showing you some images. These devices have been deployed to schools, like here at kindergarten school, inside the classroom. That's the mobile unit. And then later on, we also deployed the room unit. This is the former United States Department of Energy Secretary, Rick Perry. This is Mangdar Horani, who is the person providing the initial concept and also provided financial support. And this is Dr. Pills, who initially contacted me for this project. And so here is another image showing you the V1 unit, R1 unit, and Dr. Peel is deploying this to the government. state government, federal government buildings. Okay, and then here is another example I'm showing you. It's a total 12 filters. Each one is 24 inches by 24 inches by 12 inches deep, and total 12 of them for a HVAC system. And used to be behind here was the regular MERV filter, only 2 inches thick, and they really can only filter out the big particle. Now after we install this a large system, 12 filters, and so basically the air they are getting through this filter is basically like your clean room. So for some of you have ever used the clean room, and obviously there you don't have particles, too many particles above like say 0.1 micron. That's the system for HVAC system. Nowadays we are rolling out many more filters for the HVAC system for almost most of the buildings. In Houston and also nationwide. And then let me just tell you briefly here, so far where the how many places or just very selected a few of the many, okay? And the schools have it, like Texas, Florida, New York, California. There are many, many more, like Houston Convention Center, which is the George Brown Convention Center, Houston International Intercontinental Hotel, MD Anderson Cancer Center, Museum of Fine Arts, Disney World. Speak of Disney World, I want to tell you probably a lot of all of you know the fact that Disney, since the closing, they are losing $43 million per day. Not per month, not per year, but per day, $43 million. So they really would like to install our systems and get back to normal quickly. They have now two systems and they are testing it. Hopefully very quickly, they say that they are going to probably request if not 10,000 of them for their spaces. Also, we are developing the filters for airplanes. And one thing I want to tell you is that in fact, the existing airplanes, all the airplanes are using HEPA filter, but not heated HEPA filter like ours. They can filter the virus. It is pretty high efficiency, but they cannot kill them. And of course, there are many universities, their dorms, their classrooms, their research laboratories are trying to install our filters. So here, if you want to know more information on the different kind of systems, you can go into the company's website, for example, ivpair.com, okay? And of course, you can also send me emails, ask me about some more details. And before I end my talk, I want to give you a brief introduction of the journal which I'm handling. I'm the editor-in-chief, and we started the journal in 2017. By 2018, I could not handle the many submissions, so that's why I added associate editors, Professor David Singh at the University of Missouri, and we also, in 2019, we added Professor Takao Mori in Japan at the National Institute for Material Science. And it just as of well, sorry, I did not add her name yet or lower in picture photo. And we add another professor, Professor Yin Yu, in Central China Normal University as the third associate editor. And we have a very strong editorial board. As you can see, probably quite a lot of you are familiar with some of those well-established, well-accomplished people. And the journal starting, as I said, in 2017, and has been doing pretty well. In last year, in June of 2019, the first official impact factor came out, and it did fairly well. and the first impact factor is 10.443. And that, I'm not saying higher impact factor means the journal is absolutely good. And I think any journal, they publish good papers, also they publish not so good papers, so is our journal. And we are working hard, try to, the goal is get every paper published is a good paper, but you know, you never know, sometimes reviewers also misjudge the impact of the paper. That's very normal. And then they projected 2020 site score and impact factor. You know, last year site score was 10.5, and then this year this projection was done in June 2020. So now, in fact, this year the site score probably will be above 13, and I don't know what is the impact factor will be. Site score impact factor, they do it a little bit differently. Well, the good news here is if you put it in perspective, materials today physics, if you put into the category physics and astronomy, it ranked number 2 out of 54 such journals. And if you put it into energy category, and it ranked as number 2 out of 23 such journals. When you put it in this materials today physics into material science journals, there are many, 460 journals. They rank as 41. They're like top 10%. It's pretty good. So I welcome your submission, and I promise you, I take the first action very quickly. Normally, I don't sit on the any paper for more than 2 days. I give you the first decision, either send out for review or not send out for review. And so basically, let me summarize. I think my time is almost up. Summarize what my talk is about. So historically, physicists have made essential contributions to the society in almost every aspect. And as I showed you, you know, as a physicist, and we have to work hard. We work also smart. And I believe, even though a lot of things have been discovered, but I believe there are many more new discoveries are waiting for us. You know, especially in this spatial society, the call when society needs us, like the pandemic. And you know, when the society needs us, we as the scientists, we have to respond to make the our goal, our mission is. Do research, and the purpose of the research is make the society better and make people's life better. Okay, that's all I have for you today, and I would be more than happy to answer any questions you may have, your audience may have. Thank you very much.